Sudha, for this very broad and extremely long introduction of all the participants, all the speakers. I think, and you also spoke of yesterday's speakers, which was good in a way. I didn't know you, I thought you had introduced them yesterday, but if you hadn't, then that's good that you introduced them today. But none of them are there, I think, except Chirag, I thought has joined, and I don't know if anybody else has joined from yesterday's speakers. But let us go straight into the panel discussion now. I want to start with my ethics panel, Dr. Vasantha ma'am. I want to ask you one question, and that is, many times clinicians want to do research. They do have ideas that they're practicing clinicians. They are not attached to any institution. They're just individuals doing practice on their own. What do these people do when they want to do research in terms of an ethics committee? Which ethics committee can they approach? Ma'am?
Okay, thank you, Dr. Urmila. Good morning to everybody. And thanks to Dr. Natesh, Dr. Urmila, and Dr. Sudha for organizing this and giving me an opportunity to speak to the participants. Yes, Dr. Urmila, yours is a very, interesting questions. And then I'm sure many of the young participants, of course, today the number is less compared to yesterday. But I think those who are there and those who are new to the research area, and they'll be very much interested in this particular question. Yes, I remember that, long back in the early 2000, when the Independent Ethics Committee started, we had our own reservation as to how whether these committees should be approved, whether they should be existing, because of the same problem, which is now the question which is being asked, I think must have been felt at that time also. A lot of young researchers who want to do research, but they are not routinely involved in research, and once in a way they are involved in some clinical trials, or they come across some good observation or hypothesis which they want to try in the form for research. And once the ethics committee has become essential that all the ethics committee approvals are there, without that they cannot take part in these studies or do the studies or take part in clinical research. So there's the independent ethics committees we had started in the early 2000, around 2005, 6. I think Pfizer was the first one to organize the first independent ethics committee. Although we had reservation at that time, the drug controller, I think, for the very same question and for the problems faced by the young researchers, they agreed at that point of time, it's okay, we can approve provided they follow certain norms. So that's how now, if you see whether it is a regulation or whether it is ICMR ethical guidelines, we have given a scope for establishment of independent ethics committees, which are not attached to any particular institutions. These are committees which are organized by those who are interested in the area of ethics and who are really want to help the other researchers. They form these committees. Of course, they have to be registered as a society so that they have a legal status as an organization. So these young researchers who don't have any institutional attachment, or they have their own clinics and nursing homes, but they don't want to set up committees just for the sake of one or two studies, they can approach these independent ethics committees for an ethical review of the proposals and the protocols which they want to do that. Of course, the independent ethics committees don't do it free. There are charges which are levied by them, which varies from institution to organization to organization. But then the majority of the ethics committees, of course, do a very good job because you have people who are very knowledgeable, who are very interested in this, who are members of this committee. So just to give a short answer, yes, for these people, those who are interested, who are not attached to institutions, you can approach independent ethics committees. And if you see the 2019 rules, it's very clearly said, yes, what the independent ethics committees do, they also have to registration process and everything. So if you have a registered independent ethics committee, so you very well go to them. And but then, of course, you have to listen to their terms and conditions. They would like to do not just give approval, they would like to do monitoring, they would like to check all your documents. They may even do site monitoring at your site. You should be agreeing to all those things if it is done. Yes, absolutely. There's no problem now that in the last 20 years, almost for 50, more than 15 years, we have these independent ethics committees in the country. Yes,
Yes,
Urmila.
thank you. Thank you very much for that explanation. I want to stay on this ethics issue, Nandini. Do I have you? Nandini? Nandini, are you here?
Yeah.
So my question to you is this, academic clinical trials, you remember what academic clinical trials are? People who do purely for academic purposes, they don't do clinical trials for any commercial purposes. Now, my question to you is, do ethics committees which need to review these academic clinical trials also need to be registered with CDSCO? Do you think they should be? I don't think it says anywhere that they should be, because in fact, the DCGI says you don't have to come to him to take approval for these academic clinical trials. You go ahead, do this, but you need to allow, do you think that we should insist that they should be registered, because these clinical trials are quasi-regulatory, aren't they?
It is to be registered. That is the central point.
With DHR, with CDSCO.
No, I'm coming to that. It only it depends on what type of review they do. If they do only academic clinical, they review proposals which are only academic in nature, then they have to register with DHR. And if the same committee is also reviewing clinical trials which come under the purview of CDSCO, then they have to register with CDSCO as well. So if that institution is reviewing only academic clinical trials, and each doesn't have to register with CDSCO. And CDSCO also, initially, they were actually entertaining such registration, such types of registration, but now they are also very clear that they instruct that you go to DHR for registering. And this is actually indirectly mandated through the NDCT rules, where they very clearly state that all the institutions which are doing biomedical and health research need to abide by the ICMR guidelines 2017, and of course any further changes that may come in from time to time, and that actually mandates the ICMR guidelines as well, and they have to register with DHR. So that makes it very clear the nature of registration.
And can I add something here, Dr. Urmila?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, certainly.
When you see, look at the NDCT rules and the, for the academic trials, it is said that the, of course, these are the responsibility of the local ethics committee and the institutions. But then there is also a rider there. If an ethics committee feels this proposal is in the borderline of regulation, or which they may need the regulator's approval, they can refer it to the DCGI, CDSCO, and they have to wait for a 3 months, 30 days for the reply. If you don't get any reply, that means there is no objection, you can go ahead with that. So that means it's also that it's the academic trials are also coming in the borderline between the regulatory and the non-regulatory approvals. In case this proposed, the DCGI feels that, it should have come under the regulatory, okay, we will review it. And then what happens to the ethics committee if it is not registered with CDSCO?
That is a question. Yeah.
Wherever the, any clinical, so it, you know, it's an area where it's a little still gray, because yes, generally we say that academic trials should come under the DHR. There's no need of CDSCO unless you are doing regulatory trials. But then if a study comes which gets referred, and then if the DCJ accepts it, it becomes then a regulatory monitoring will be done. And then, of course, you should have the registration. So
yes,
it is, I think, still there. It is in the, it's a gray area now, that maybe afterwards they have to register. So I don't know how things are happening. Earlier, everybody was registering only with CDSCO. So the issue was not there. But now that you have a clear-cut demarcation, where all ethics committees need not be registered with CDSCO, you have to go to the DHR, of course, is mandatory for everybody. CDSCO is only an additional one. So this question will come, if academic trials are referred and accepted by that, then, and if it is not registered, will it be okay? Will there be a problem?
There's another point also, people are not aware that every institutional ethics committee has to register. those institutions which are not actually entertaining any regulatory clinical trials, they are not aware that their ethics committee also needs to be registered. And this is more true for all the institutions in the Ayush sector. The rules only say biomedical health research, so it's common to all. So that realization was not there. Now, of course, they have started realizing that and they are registering. And they feel that it's a welcome step, actually.
Yeah, I think that's a training that we did for the CCRAS and their institutions was probably very useful.
Yes,
can I just
that,
move
yeah.
on now to Dr. Arasar? My question to you both, actually, and one of you can answer, and both of you can answer one after the other, is what will you do? What do we need to do to encourage device research? Knowledge of devices is also very poor, or at least the regulatory aspects of devices and how to handle it. Ethics committees themselves are not very aware about devices and research on devices and anything that the regulations on devices. What can be done to encourage this kind of research? Because most of the research that's being done is on drugs, as Sudha also mentioned. What can be done, do you think?
After you, sir, if, unless you want me to go first. Is it, sir?
Yeah, Amit, you can handle this.
Sure, sure. So, ma'am, thank you for the question. Actually, this was, you know, the revelation also for us, for me personally, when we joined the device industry after more than 15 years in pharma. So the biggest challenge in device industry is that, ma'am, not only the physician, but even the companies do not understand their devices very well. Because here, the clinical trials have not been conducted to such an extent that we know of our product. For example, in previous lives, if I say atorvastatin, we know from our, you know, MBBS days what is atorvastatin, and we know till the end what it can do. And if we are doing any new drug, then also we used to have our phase 1, phase 2, phase 3 data with us. And any change in formulation, that is also very clear, because we work very closely with the PK/PD concepts of the drugs. Basically, the pharmaceutical world is based on the pharma knowledge. And the pharma knowledge is very, very clear, right? The guardrails are very clear in that. However, ma'am, device, what happens is, for example, I am now launching approximately 4 to 5 new devices. Out of those, 2 are first time in India. Still, no clinical trials are required. So that is beyond our comprehension, that because there is a predicate, the rules are like that, it is only a Cat2 device, or it is only a, you know, whatever the reasons are. So what happens is that when we have started having the conversations with investigators, sometimes the conversations become very funny. We think that doctors know the product well, and doctors think that we are the expert. So what we have realized is that in our devices, first of all, there are certain features that we talk about, but how that features they get converted into benefits is not clear to industry. And it is not like drug that once we give it to one patient or 2 patients or 3 patients, unless we talk about some genomic or genetic level differences, the drug behaves like a drug. But if we look at an injection, even a simple thing like injection or a scalpel, right? So they will behave as the doctor wants them to behave. So from our industry to stand, coming to the specifics, we were discussing, you know, I went to a very renowned doctor to discuss about one of his ideas and proposals regarding the research. So the problem that we are facing is that, first of all, they have not been used to doing clinical research unless they are the doctors who are a part of the pharmaceutical industry as well. So in devices, first of all, they will not understand the importance of ethics committee. I mean, one example, I told one doctor that, you know, we'll need an ethics committee. So he said, no, no, that is not required. This product is already approved, right? So I said, sir, product is approved, but still we will need, because by mistake, I spoke the word prospective, but just by mistake, I mean, because it is a prospective trial and we have humans involved, we need ethics committee. So he said, okay, no, don't worry. I will collect the data and then we can do this research after 6 months. So it will become retrospective. So these kind of very innovative ideas come to their mind. So the primarily the problem is that they do not understand the
context. Just one problem, just one thing, Amit. I think it's important to highlight that even for retrospective studies, you need ethics committee clearance. That, I mean, this is for the audience, but yeah. there are some clinicians here.
Thank you for clarifying, ma'am. Yes, exactly. And when we talk about endpoints, ma'am, they do not understand even the simple points, like they want to have 4 or 5 endpoints in a trial. I mean, I tell them that if we have the complex endpoints, our sample size will increase. According to them, the very funny conversations that we cannot have 500 patients in device, we will only have 50 to 100. So let's put as many endpoints in primary as possible. That is what they think. And I tell them that if it is a smaller sample size, I need even a cleaner endpoint. So the problem is that, first of all, the overall understanding of ICA-GCP, the understanding of ethics committee, statistics, endpoints, everything is significantly lacking. And the problem arises because they have been traditionally, I'll tell you that cardiologists, they have been traditionally in the cath labs doing operations morning till late night. But now, because of price control, somehow I feel that they have got lesser inclination towards putting the devices or stents, but they have some better time for academics or for research. And they say, why will I take unnecessary radiation if it is not really of commercial benefit to us? Probably that is also a reason. So they have started coming to the research recently, and that is why it is a very good time that we are collaborating with them. In Terumo, we have a very world-class simulation lab. We get them here for hands-on operation, for stent deployment, for multiple things. We have got a Mentis system. It is more than crore or two. And then here we are also giving them information about ICA-GCP, study designs, primary endpoints, statistical analysis. And we have started doing small workshops. I hope the things will change, but the problem is very evident and very stark in front of us.
Dr. Naidu, can I bring you in here? Yes, 1 minute, Nandini. I just want to ask Dr. Naidu. Dr. Naidu, are you there? Dr. Naidu?
Yes.
Can you please unmute yourself?
Sir is there.
Yeah.
So Dr. Naidu, I was wondering, how can you generate this interest in research amongst people? Is it possible for us to start training these people at the time and with their medical students? Because according to me, that is when people are the most moldable. They are able to listen and imbibe things. And I feel that undergraduate medical students are the best targets to teach medical research. Have you any experience with this and what is your guidance? Yeah.
Definitely what you are telling, I am 100% interested that the research or clinical research, all these things has to be even a curriculum in the pharmacology. Because now I understand that there are some actually very good training center in Hyderabad. When actually they are advertising, I find so many people are actually joining that center for the clinical training. And some people, those who are actually MD and other people are there, when they come for the classes or something, we have got the question answer session. We found that even very simple things are there that they are not understanding. And when really they become actually investigator, or when actually they are joining some institution and working as a maybe the staff member or something, we come across that they don't have any idea of research and talk about disease committee and translation of these things are there. Then they always usually try to avoid taking actually interest in doing research. The reason is that actually they say that we are not very well trained, we don't know so many things, so usually they want to avoid. So I definitely want that if we inculcate this type of training or information during the undergraduate and postgraduate mandatory, definitely these people will be becoming interested, and we will get more number of investigators, because when we search for investigator, those who are really involved, if you see that investigator initiated trial in India is very, very less. The reason is that first is interest, and second, most of the time they are telling that we are not aware so many things like compensation and so many other issues, reporting of ADR and other things are there. So personally, I definitely want that there may be a short, actually may not be number of lectures, but minimum about the ethics committee, about the protocol writing and ADR monitoring. These things have to be included into curriculum, and definitely even I agree that in now they are telling that the practical in animal and all those things they have removed in pharmacology. I agree. But whether they have suggested what is the alternative, I tell here it is the alternative there, very simple non-invasive methods which can be taken by them to understand clinical research. Simple, like you know that the pain induction by using actually blood pressure apparatus, and we can actually explain them that, okay, this is the protocol, this is the informed consent, this is the data, like that. So there are very simple non-invasive methods which can be incorporated as a part of actually practical during the MD pharmacology. So they will be just doing simulation. There is no need. Even actually healthy volunteer, their classmate, actually they can be volunteer. They can know that how actually informed consent should be written, and what are the component of that. This is only possible that if actually some practicals are made mandatory during MD pharmacology. So I am very much for that, that once they come, they definitely, when they go to industry, it becomes very difficult for them to understand so many, even regulatory requirement, very small regulatory requirement, they are telling, no, we have not actually read in pharmacology. But if those information that what type of guidelines are there, what various type of ethical requirement, at least when they go and they work in industry or work in a hospital where we wanted them to do clinical trial, they will be very happy to do. And most important, that for industry it will be very easy to identify a correct trained investigator.
Yes, thank you. Nandini, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, I actually had been confronted with some people about, classification of the devices. Most of them, the class one and class two, it need not be approved by CDSCO. So what these manufacturers try to do is try to put it in the class two category, so that the state FDA alone can give the approval. I came across one such case where it was put into the category two, class two, and therefore did not require CDSCO approval. And the state FDA gave the approval, and then they approached one hospital and wanted a particular investigator to undertake that trial. They didn't name it as a trial, but they said in three patients. So what sort of research is this? What is this? There's absolutely, no clarity whether it is research, whether it, that particular device comes into class three. So that's a very gray area, actually. And the other point that I wanted to highlight was about the training. In biotech, I had to do one the interview with the industry heads, etc. So I came across this suggestion, especially one company. After doing this MSc biotech, it's the same story as Dr. Naidu said, that the graduates actually don't know how to do clinical trials. So they have absolutely no idea about what biotech is in reality. So what this company did was, during the summer holidays, when they have some break in between, they let these MSc people to come to their labs. And they don't allow them entry to the prohibited areas, but they come and see all the state of art instruments and things like that, how they go about it and all that, and they become more aware of the real world about biotech. So similarly, the pharma companies can also have, you know, training, like you have internship, pharmacology students really having, say, even 1 week of exposure, if that can be organized, that would actually teach them much more about the practical side of what you call clinical trial. Thanks.
Thank you very much. That was also very interesting. Dr. Arasan, would you like to give in some inputs about how do we encourage more research, more awareness about devices, especially amongst ethics committees? Nobody in ethics committees knows anything about devices, including what are the regulations that currently rule device research. You're muted, I think, sir. If you could unmute yourself.
I would. I'm not a device specialist and I don't have much experience. I think Amit would be a better person on the device side.
He already told us his opinion. Okay, I'm sorry. I thought
that's
the introduction.
I'm a pharmacologist, industry pharmacologist, so I would like to stay put with the therapeutics related.
Okay. I'm sorry.
In fact, before the meeting started, raising the question, which was raised by another making
saying, Dr. Arasan, could you mute yourself, please?
Sure.
That is, most of the ethics committees, like you highlighted, most of the ethics committees don't know the intricacies of how a device works and what are the ethical aspects regarding that. So these people actually wanted for the ethics committees about what the devices mean and what are the ethical aspects regarding that, so that they get exposed to what can happen and what would be the solution. So that would lead to greater understanding and removal of blocks.
Removal of blocks is a good explanation. Okay, Dr. Arasan, I have a question for you then. Many clinicians, as I asked Vasantha Madam, want to do research, but they don't know how to go about it. Do you have any idea what we can do to train them? Because I remember Dr. Nanim, long ago when he was in Pfizer, had told us about how to do a trial amongst clinical practitioners, general practitioners, with some anti, I think, worm drug, and how useful that simple research was, and how we could use this huge, human resource to do such a simple trial. So what do you think should be the way forward to encourage to take all these people into research? That is my first question. And the second question is, when you choose, you know, there are, okay, I'll ask you the second question later. You answer this first. About how do you take clinicians into your repertoire of clinical trialists?
And they, you know, we have all the private practitioners having good database, number one. Number two is the data collection and the data storage has improved a lot with electronic health records and things like that. The individual doctors also have come of age as compared to, let us say, a decade back. There's quite a lot of improvement in the clinical setting. I'll give you one example. I am part of associates of cardiologists, education, research, and training. I'm handling the, I'm chief of their quality control, as well I handle their ethics committee and the chairman for the ethics committee as well. You know, kind of a mentor for the research. Basically, there are 250 eminent interventional cardiologists who are all there. They all are attached to tertiary hospital. And they started this in spite of the fact that they have this CSI and things like that. That I don't want to get into that topic, but the point is an example. How they have come together is that they were all research-minded. They were interested to do research. And they felt that there is a need. They have the data. So the first thing that we started, how we encouraged is, this is, I think, my personal example, very recent example, not a very 20-year back example. So what I started with is, we first started with a registry plan, right? A registry is reasonably a kind of a data collection, then, you know, it's kind of a data analysis and then your presentation. So, but again, a registry requires all kinds of data. We will discuss about registry and things like that later, but basically registry also is a research, right? So that is a simpler and a very, very quick point to get onto board with research. So we have we have trained this 250 cardiologists over this lockdown period. We had this good advantage of, some of them were little relatively free as compared to the previous times. So we used that time and the key thing is, of course, you know, we took the time for, you know, getting the, you know, CKSA, you know, approval from DCGI for the ethics committee, conducting the ethics committee during this lockdown period. Again, you know, doing the CTRA registration. So we did this. We took the CDSU approval. Although it is not an interventional thing, or it's not, it is an interventional, but you know, it's not like a prospective study, it's a kind of a record analysis, but still we took the CDSCO approval, mainly while they said that, you know, you don't have to come to us, but we still insisted that, you know, it's better that you give us, because we don't know what kind of drugs they will be adding up. So we finally got it cleared. So my point I'm here adding is that small groups, I'm also heading this Indian Medical Association's requirements. So we, even in small groups, let us say 5-10 doctors can form a kind of a understanding, let us say. It need not be a well-formed consortium, but you know, they can pull up the data. So associations should play a role. So let us say if we have to, I as an industry person, I motivate the associations. So I spend time on the association leaders and tell them that, you know, can you do this? I tell them and then motivate. And that is how, you know, as an industry person, I get a lot of access to a lot of data. On one side, interventional data, on the other side, you know, retrospective data. And all of them, you know, of course, it can go through the independent ethics committee approval, you know, get all the regulatory compliance and things like that. But the key is, we have a lot of data and a lot of people are unaware. So we create the awareness from industry. This is what I do as an industry person. I personally go meet these guys, tell them and, you know, conduct small workshops. And if you talk to 100 people, sometimes 5 people, 10 people come forward, right? And finally, maybe 3 will stick to you. But if the 3 come out with some kind of a successful value, that leads to 30. The exponential jump, then around you don't have to worry. So it's my personal experience, initial takeoff is very tough, but once it takes off beautifully. So today we have very successful publications coming out from Kerala, from the cardiologists and from Tamil Nadu, and you know, we are working with Maharashtra Council, so quite a lot across the country. So it is possible. If you are able to form, you go through these associations or all group of physicians, right? And somebody should bell the cat. So industry persons, we are interested in the data. So we certainly motivate people. So
I want to go to Sudha now, actually. Are you here, Sudha? Are you still here, Sudha?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
I know you're not formally a panelist, but you're a young pharmacologist in a medical college. So I want to ask you, what do you think are your challenges to do clinical trials of industry? See, the main topic of today's and yesterday's discussion was about industry coming to academic centers to do clinical trials. So yes, what is it that, do you do clinical trials in the first place? It may be a wrong person to ask you if you're doing, I don't know.
No, ma'am.
Why don't you do? What are your challenges? Because we heard what challenges Dennis told us about. We heard what challenges Nitya told us about yesterday. But these people are themselves successful. And yes, I know Nitya's challenges. I've been with her throughout with all the challenges, and we've held hands and gone forward and just, you know, done this because we were convinced that we needed to do this. But what do you think are your major challenges?
Ma'am, actually, I speak on behalf of all the institutions in and around our place. I was working in Kollam, Kerala, which is in a self-financing medical college. We do have good infrastructure, good resources. But for two reasons, I don't know if I can say this on record, Kerala as such, clinical trials, we find it difficult, except in places like Sri Chitra Tirunal or, even Government Medical College, Trivandrum does some studies, but not regulatory studies that I have come across. RCC previously has done some studies, but due to some issues or the mindset of the people, doing trials in Kerala is slightly difficult. I really don't know if I can quote on a national forum like this, but trust me, I have worked here for 10 years and I feel it is, we have a lot of other challenges. That is one thing. Second thing, ma'am, I would really like to mention, I am not belittling any institution. We all, as medical colleges, tertiary care centers, we have facility, but trained people, personnel, resource, faculty available, trainings provided by for our postgraduate students or the interest that the academicians themselves have is very minimal in many institutions. As an academic investigator, being in a medical college, though we have in certain departments very good clinical material, performing industry-sponsored trials is quite a challenge even to this day. And I can, confidently say this is not my problem alone. Many of us in many medical colleges who are working for a long time, we face this challenge for multiple reasons. One, trained faculty or personnel. When the industry approaches, we do not know how to approach industry. Industry doesn't, sponsors don't know how to approach us, except for some places like KEM, JIPMA, KMC, I can name all the big centers. But apart from that, smaller colleges or institutions, we have tremendous potential. But I don't know how, probably these are, this is one of the first where we are interacting on a panel where people can approach. There is a gap between these two. Bridging this gap is very essential. Dr. Dennis and ICR is doing very good work. IMPA itself on their platform is providing this. So I was talking about the challenges that we face. One is of the trained faculty or personnel. Second is of the ethics committees. Many of the ethics committees, even today, are not registered with DHR or not registered with CDSCO. I can definitely say this, and many of the IECs don't even meet once a month. Yesterday, for one of the questions, I was asking madam that if we can make ICMR guideline, can suggest some minimal number of meetings, because people don't meet. It's like whether virtually or otherwise, there is no limitation as such, but they don't meet. Frankly speaking, things don't happen. And thirdly, last the challenge we face is bridging this gap between the sponsor and the institution, because institutional policies in many a place, though institutions are willing, they want to provide administrative support, they don't know how to do it. So I think training academicians and good communication between the sponsor and the academia, this could solve some of the problems. These are the three main challenges that I have faced being in a institution for a long time, though we have in some places, some departments, we have very good clinical material. Ma'am, these are the common problems that you have.
Thank you, Sudha. That was very nicely put, I think. Nandini and Pasanta, ma'am, can you please comment about how we can encourage training of ethics committees? We've been doing a lot of these trainings across the country. Can you talk more about how we can encourage ethics committees to be trained? And secondly, about her comment about, can we put some kind of limitation in the next ethics guideline that you at least must have three meetings per year or 12 meetings per year or whatever it is.
Yes, thanks. Yes, ethics training is something, of course, that's the main work which we have been, of course, concentrating all along for the last many years, in addition to training the researchers, undergraduate, postgraduate, you know, other clinical trial researchers and all. So ethics committee registration, of course, all along we have been, of course, talking about it, that at the moment the most important component of this entire research arena is the ethics committee, because they are the ones who are supposed to be at least knowledgeable about all the ethical issues, how to handle them, and how to give advice to the researchers for doing the necessary modifications. And if you are depending on the ethics committees, of course, their training is the most important. That's the reason, of course, we formed the FERSI, we formed the FERCAP. So all these are all for training of ethics committees. And then, in spite of the fact that we have conducted training programs across the country, in large number of institutions, but still, I think it's only a drop in the ocean compared to the actual need which is there in this country, as rightly pointed out by Sudha. The need is much more, but what we have done, in spite of doing so much, I think it's very little. Now, one thing which has happened now, which is, of course, very, it's a very positive thing, is with the DHR registration, it has become now, anyway, all the institutions, and so ethics committees or independent ethics committees have to now register with the DHR. And in the DHR registration, what has become made mandatory is the training of the EC members. So they are undertaking, for those members, they have to submit the EC training certificate of all the members. And those people who have not yet trained, they have to give an undertaking that within the next 6 months, they will undergo the training and submit a certificate. Of course, the kind of training which is going on at the moment is far from the, you know, what is actually needed. We are having short-term training programs of half a day or just 1 day, which of course may not be actually sufficient for everybody to understand the whole implications of the various issues, but at least that gives them a general idea of what should be the role of ethics committees and what is it which they should know minimum. That's what is happening now. So at least now that the training has become mandatory indirectly, now this is now will happen. There are a lot of things which we I see around that people want to undergo this training, whether it is for the learning purposes or more because the otherwise the DHR registration, they may see that if you are not trained and not submitted certificate, they may even cancel your registration or can hold on to the registration. Maybe the fear of that, but yes, there is some interest going on. So that's the first level of minimal training. The ethics committees or the institutions themselves should take up the interest that when they have set up a committee and they have to know that all the members as well as the researchers are trained. Because unless you do the training of all of them, the researchers won't realize why an ethics committee is raising questions, why they are asking them to do so many changes and modifications. Just training the ethics committee members alone is not sufficient. So we have to have training the ethics committee members as well as researchers, sometimes maybe together, and then there are certain components will be separately also. Although the research methodology courses have become mandatory under the MCAE regulation and people are doing it, the ethics component in that seems to be very limited. So people have to have more of that. So I think that at least from what I have seen 30 years back when this whole started, a lot of changes have happened. Of course, still we have to go far way to go. But I think with all these regulations coming into force, changes are happening. And I think what is necessary at the moment is we have to prepare a mini module, you know, a minimum module which has to be done by all the centers. There is no such, you know, anything at the moment. So we are doing it on our own, what is necessary, which we think. But I think the ICMR or the CDSO, they have to come out with a minimum requirement of what should be part of the training. And then the institutions have to organize this on their own. It's not, they should not depend on ICMR or DBT or somebody to do that. To some extent, government can do that, but it's all a responsibility of the institution themselves, whether they are private or public sector, to see that the necessary trainings are organized. And we are all always there to help them. And there are many more people who are trained now in the country. It's not like the earlier 20 years back, we could only count few people, but now we have hundreds of trained people. So they have to make use of them and conduct training in their own institutions for the sake of people getting knowledge and not for the sake of just fulfilling the requirement of the DSA registration.
Thank you, madam. We're running out of time and I want to bring in Dr. Naidu again. Dr. Naidu, are you there still? Dr. Naidu, can you please unmute yourself?
Yeah.
I wanted to ask you a question related to industry, small time industry, you know, small startups, new startups, small industry. Why are they not so interested in research, in spending money on research? And why is it that, is it only because their total outlay is small, therefore they do not want to spend any amount on research? Or why is it that, I mean, this is true for all over the country. Nobody is interested in research. Why is that so? And what can be done to increase this research interest?
It's a very important thing, as you are really telling, that even if you today see that some of the new drugs, especially which are, I'm just telling because I was doing some phase one trial, always I found that it was developed by actually big companies like Bocard or Sun Pharma or Dr. Reddy's lab. They are coming forward and coming for phase one, but we are not able to get actually any small pharma industry coming and asking us to do trial. The reason what actually I found that most of the people, they are just actually developing first me-too drug or some drug delivery system which they develop. And for drug delivery system or improvement in the formulation, as for regulation, actually, they only need to do BABA study and those centers are there. There are only few companies, those who are really interested to do actually their studies into the part coming to the institution. Here one problem we face, that when they come to institution, there are many requirements. For example, even I tell you that the ethical committee approval fee in some actually institution is about 30,000. And then the investigation charges and all, when they actually look the real, this is a real budget when we produce to them, even simple for approving ethics committee, my institution, you have to pay 30,000 for these investigation, which is to be done in NABL accredited lab, this is the cost. And so they usually, most of the time, they ask us to reduce the number of subjects, which actually statistically very, very difficult. This is one major concern out there. So I only suggest that there is one possibility which we also tried, that if you are asking that a small industry to do the study and go for the funding from outside, the problem happens that I can't say that it is an academic in research. If in the form of academic research, the industry is telling, we have got a problem that I cannot use this material for my promotion. So they are actually, they are interested only to develop a data which they can use for selling their this thing. So that is one of the problem with the small industry. They cannot actually give really amount of drug which is there, like compensation. When we tell as per the new guideline, this much may be the compensation as per the protocol. So cost of the clinical trial is really one of the major issue with small countries, small companies are there. But there are ways that one can actually think of going jointly applying for the funding to the national organizations like ICMR, CSIR or other. I just give an example. There is a very small company from actually UP, almost about 15 years back. They have developed a very potent immunomodulator. And they are telling that this immunomodulator may be very effective if it is used in patient with AIDS, it will improve actually immunity. Now, how to do the trial? We have written the protocol, how many number of subject is required. We calculated the cost. It was coming somewhere about 50 to 60 lakh because we have to do actually CD4, CD8, viral load, all those things. The company is telling I am very much interested because my drug is really working very well, how it can be done. Then what we did actually, we went to NACO, that is the National AIDS Control Organization. We told sir, this is a company, they have got this drug, would like to work. And I tell you, actually NACO has given 60 lakhs to us. We have done this study and fortunately study has very clearly shown that it was effective in the AIDS patient and helping in improving immunology. So there are some ways that if a small companies coming, they cannot fund the clinical research in the academic institution because of, like I telling, the various costs, NABL accredited lab costs. So only thing is that if they are not able to pay, one can go to the national institutions and we can actually put our proposal and get the funding. Funding is one of the major things. Second thing, what actually we come across, that the large companies, like big companies, they have got their actually a clinical research unit with them. They don't actually go to CRO for preparing protocol, case record form, ethics committee. But when a small company comes to us, we say that, okay, we want protocol, we want actually the informed consent translation case record form, then they look for CRO. CRO are start charging very high. So that is one of the major problems because they have to work through CRO as compared to large company. That is another major issue that small companies are not coming forward to doing a clinical research in academic institution.
I think there's one more
important point is that the timeline for the delivery of the results. See, what happens in a normal, you know, let us say a company wants to have some kind of, you know, data. They expect a timeline of, let us say, about, say, 1 year, 2 years. Companies think about 2 years, 3 years. 3 years is quite a long time for a small company to visualize for 5 years and 10 years for a dumb example I give you. You want to make an AC inhibitor as a long acting one, whether it is needed or not, that's a different issue. I'm just taking a dumb example. Then when do you expect the results to come, right? The companies will normally expect the results to come in 1.5 years maximum. Marketing, if you ask the marketing guys in the company, they would say we want it this year itself, which is not possible, but it would take at least 1.5 or 2 years. Typical time that is delivered is about 3 years. Even to start a study in an academic institution, the levels of bureaucracy that we have created, the levels of committee that are there in an organization, you have the ethics committee, very decent, acceptable. But then, you know, on top of the ethics committee, there is scientific review committee. Then there is a kind of a committee called, you know, let us say you go to a central institute, they have something like that. This is a public-private partnership committee. They create committees. I mean, I have to be very open here. Committees are many, and sometimes these layers have to be, and the principal investigator would be interested initially, but then the amount of dragging that goes on into it, at some point of time, the principal investigator says, yeah, somebody has to, you know, take care of that. So my feeling is that even academic institutions also, see, reputed and well-established institutions have that, you know, running very free-flowing mechanism. Whereas there are lots of smaller institutions or newer institutions have committees, and most of the time the committees are filled with people who are jobless, right? And those guys sit and keep on asking questions and, you know, they push here and, you know, it's kind of a bureaucratic play. So I think these are all ecosystem issues one has to address, even in within the medical colleges. Those colleges which have not been doing a lot of work, right? The amount of committees are very difficult. Right now, we have one program going on in a very major institution. But to overcome all the committees and to start the study, it took about 9 months. We could recruit only 5 patients now. So this is, and you know, we have to recruit about 400 patients. Can you imagine where is the study going to be? You know, this is a typical roadblock. It's a kind of a huge roadblock. I think typically ecosystem also has to look at it. And financially, 50, 60 lakhs is acceptable to a moderate sized company. But sometimes the quotes are something like 5 crores, 4 crores. So companies say 4 crore, 5 crores, and you know, 3-4 years time, you know, let's try and find a simpler way, right? And that's how we guys who handle the medical strategies and things like that, we do have the limitations. I think we have to work on the whole ecosystem, right? You have a lot of policymakers here, and you know, the central government experienced people and people like that are here. So I think you all have to come out with some kind of an ecosystem plan, you know, therefore, you know, this is all facilitated. Because the eagerness is there. But as like Dr. Doherty said, we are a generic industry. So therefore, most of the products are copy products. We don't have to do any big research because the innovator has done the research, and there is no data protection also. Whatever you do, the study, that study will be taken by 100 other companies, and so you don't have any motivation to do a lot of work for your own particular product in spite of all that. So these are some of the issues from the industry side, you know, how we face on a daily basis.
Yeah, thank you very much. I must say, on the other hand, and Dr. Sudha, this is for you also, that I don't think AEM Hospital or any other major hospital doesn't have its own share of obstacles. Even Dr. Naidu will agree with me that we have also faced obstacles all our lives, and we have to use these obstacles as opportunities. You know, the ethics committee also, we may be having a very good ethics committee, but it can itself be an obstacle for us as an investigator. You know, some investigators may be thinking ethics committees are obstacles, but we have to think of them as opportunities to learn and learn how to deal with these things in a timely manner. And I think that is where we lack. We give up very quickly. And I think I want to tell all the young people, if there are any people left amongst the audience, that we must not lose hope. We have to keep hope, because that is all that keeps us going, especially in today's day and age with all these pandemic and lockdown and everything going on. So I think I want to take this opportunity now to close this panel discussion, because we've gone way over time. I took this time only because we actually started the discussion exactly an hour ago, because we spent a lot of time in the introduction. So thank you very much, all panelists.
Hi, Dr. Umia. We have 48 participants as of now.
Okay. So do the participants have any questions? We have any questions?
Right now in the chat, ma'am, I cannot see any questions. No. They have congratulated us for organizing this amazing platform, and Dr. Vivek Sharma conveyed his sincere thanks to all the panelists for organizing.
So if there is any question from amongst the participants, I'll be happy to deal. Sure. I mean, I think our panelists will be happy to deal with them. Can anybody like to ask any question? Please ask questions. Don't say congratulations. Thank you very much for your congratulations. You get that point. But if there are any questions, please ask them.
Dear participants, if you have any questions, please write in your questions in the chat directly, and our panelists will address it. Thank you so much.
If anyone can ask questions directly, They can unmute themselves.
They can ask also, yeah, but not everybody shouldn't unmute together. Otherwise, it becomes
Just for the hygiene purpose and to avoid any background noises and a lot of, so we have kept the audiences on mute for the hygiene purpose. But if they can write in the chat pod, we can address the question. And if any audiences, any attendee want to ask a question, please write in the chat box and I can make them the panelists, and then they can unmute themselves and ask the questions on the audio as well. So dear attendees.
We've asked now several times. I don't see any questions in the chat box. I think we should just wrap up now, because we really run out of time. It's almost 12 o'clock.
One point.
Yes, Nandini.
This is about training. You have the 8 com now. So that's a wonderful opportunity for, priming the students about what informed consent processes, expose them to the exercise of making informed consent documents, and also have mock IRBs. This is what we had actually tried in ICMR for the undergraduate training course. So that actually makes them more compliant when they become investigators later in life. The resistance down, the understanding becomes even more. And even the FS committee also, some of the members who are from the scientific field from the medical colleges, they also would be more familiar about the difficulties in the informed consent documents, etc., and will appreciate that much for the chance to.
Yes. You know something, I will reiterate this 1,000,000 times, that you will never learn anything unless you do it. You have to do a clinical trial to learn the challenges in a clinical trial and to understand how to do the clinical trial. So I request everybody to please do it. Do clinical trials, get involved. I don't see any questions.
Ma'am, there's one audience. One question from Dr. Ilamati. Please unmute her, no?
I am trying to find her in the panelist, in the attendee list, but I could not figure out. Just allow me a moment, please, and I'll put her on the panel. Okay, here is Dr. Ilamati. Okay, so Dr. Ilamati, now you are in the panel.
Good morning, thank you for wonderful speech and I just want to
ask. Can't hear you. I'm sorry. We can't hear you at all. No, can't hear you at all.
Yeah, but I have kept the full volume. Still not able to hear. I mean,
it's better now.
Okay, madam. Actually, I just have a doubt. If he's working in a particular medical college and the ethics committee has cleared the topic and title, the protocol has been approved. But the fact that he goes to another medical college, can they continue? They have not started the project in the previous institute. Can they start the project based on the clearance from the ethics committee from the previous medical college in the new institute?
Vasanta madam, would you take this question? Her question is that she is working in one institute. She's got clearance from the ethics committee in that institute. Now she's got transferred to another institute. Can she continue with the same original ethics committee approval?
You cannot see wherever you, first of all, when you are going to another institution and want to take the study along with you, you have to take the approval of both the institutions. The institution where you originally worked, they should agree for you to take your study there. And if that ethics is given, when you're going to a new institution, the new institute also should agree for you to bring that. And then, of course, that your further monitoring will be done by the new institution where you are now joined. So you have to get their ethics committee approval also. So just taking one ethics committee's approval, you cannot work in some other institution.
No, I think the second institution where you are going to do a trial, it is must to take approval of that ethics committee. Reason is that actually one of the requirement of ethics committee to check about the resources, a particular type of trial which you are doing in your old institution that may be having particular thing which may not be existing in this particular institution. So it is mandatory that wherever the site in that you are doing clinical trial, you have to take a approval from that institution. Secondly, that if you are not taking that, how actually the monitoring will be done? The monitoring has to be done where the clinical trial is done. So it is mandatory that you have to take approval to the place where actually transferred and take approval, because they have to check all the requirements for your clinical trial, even number of patients, whether they are coming, type of investigation you want to do, whether they can do, all these things are necessary and monitoring. So it is mandatory that they should take the approval from the second institution where you want to do clinical trial.
Yeah, as I said, you have to take the first of all approval from the first institution for taking the project with you, because generally what happens when the individual goes, the projects remain in the institute. Whoever is the co-investigator will now take over as the investigator for the study. We have been having this problem in many centers. So you have to get the approval of both the institutions.
No, this was an idea of mine, and the protocol was written by carried out, except for the ethics committee approval.
So when you are leaving, but you would have got the approval of that ethics committee of the first institution. They would have given you the permission. So you have to take the permission of that institution to carry this your project with you. And of course, wherever you are joining, as Dr. Naidu said, and as I said earlier, this is the institution which is going to permit you to do the study. They have to see whether all the necessary requirements are there in the institute or not. And they will have to do the monitoring by looking at your annual reports, progress reports. So without their approval, you just can't do anything in a new institute unless you take their approval. So
is something like actually institutional site approval also. So you got actually approval in your first institution. As the requirement from the sponsor or as the investigator, there is necessary that you should also have a approval from your institute. For example, compensation, or if any problem comes, what is going to happen to the participant. So this new institution should agree to all the requirement which you are actually already got on your previous. Suppose there is ICU requirement during clinical trial. So the new institution should be agreeing for that. So it is mandatory that you must take a approval, and the ethics committee has to approve all and everything which actually you want to do in this new institution. It should be fulfilled.
I understand, sir, because monitoring also this cannot be institute. Thank you so much, madam and sir.
I think we should Dr. Revati, hi,
this is Nasni. So Dr. Revati have a question. Dr. Revati, put you in the panel now, and I'm going to unmute your mic. Please go ahead and ask your question, Dr. Revati. Thank you.
Please also say to whom this question is addressed.
Hello?
Yes, Dr. Revati, we can hear you.
Yeah, I would like to ask Dr. Vasantha Muthuswamy, is there any jurisdiction regarding the area for the independent ethics committee?
So I don't understand, what do you mean by the jurisdiction?
That is because once when I was in college in Pondicherry,
yes,
I wanted to apply for one clinical trial.
Yes.
But our institutional ethical committee was not registered that time. So when I approached one independent ethics committee, then I was told that in Pondicherry, I have to approach only some people, ethics committee there, not in Tamil Nadu. Like, so is there any restriction?
The first is, if you have an ethics committee in your institution, okay?
Yeah.
And whether they are registered or not registered, you have to take approval only from your own institute. Okay, when you have your own institute, you can't go to any outside institution.
Okay,
if it is some regulatory study, if your institution is not yet registered with the CDSCO, but still you want to do the trial, and if your institution gives you permission to go to any other institute,
Yeah.
Then you have to go to another institute which is registered already, so that you can get the approval. Now, okay, under the regulation, they have put a distance of it should be within a 50-kilometer radius. Okay, this is under the Indian regulation. They say the monitoring of the ethics committee can be done only if it is within a distance of 50 kilometers.
Okay.
According to the regulations, you have to follow that. But if it is a study which is not regulated, of course, the question of this registration doesn't come there. But always remember that with you have to take approval of your own ethics committee and institution to go to somewhere outside. And that has to be a registered committee, whether it's independent or you can go to any other institution also if they are ready to accept it. If it is there in the SOP that they will accept proposals from other institution, you can go to them also. But as to the drug regulation, you should remember they have kept this limit of 50 kilometers. Anyway, I don't know the logic behind that 50 kilometers, but that's the rule now. You have to know that.
Okay, madam.
Thanks. I think the idea of 50 kilometers is that the ethics committee can go and actually monitor that site. They should be in a
Of
course, they can fly also now. But
anybody can fly. They want to do monitoring. The institution very ready to pay. People can fly. They can go by any other thing. Not necessary. 50 kilometers only you can go by road. Even 100 kilometers you can go by road by car. So this 50 kilometers, I don't understand, but that's a rule. Now that's a law. So if it is, because I know of institutions where we have seen problem that they got registered, they went to some other institution and it was subjected that it's more than 50 kilometers. So they have to search for an institution within a 50 kilometer radius. And this institution which gave approval had not much of experience in the clinical trials at all, except that they've got themselves registered with the CDSCO. That's the only positive thing there. So there are still, you know, a lot of issues around this. But anyway, as of now, you have to follow the rules. According to the rules, the jurisdiction distance is 50 kilometers.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. I think I have to end now because we're beyond 12 o'clock and all the panelists are busy people. They must be having other responsibilities and other jobs. Again, I want to say a big thank you from the bottom of my heart to all the panelists for making this so interesting and exciting. Many of our questions have been ethical. Please excuse me if I have focused more on the ethics than on anything else. But that is because anyway, ethics is so important and crucial to the whole issue. Thank you again, everyone. And thank you, Natesh, for inviting me to be a part of this and as well as to be a part of this whole workshop. And thank you for organizing it in the first place. I think we must encourage more interactions with between industry and academics. And Natesh, I do look forward to more panel discussions and more interactions and more talks so that we do encourage this kind of interaction. Thank you again. And thank you all.
Natesh, you, after this particular discussion, I understood one very important issue. Why actually we are having all issues related to clinical trial in India, why these people are not doing. To me, I think there is a lot of lack of education. So I am very much think that we should think of actually, as madam is telling, that some module for training of all the stakeholders of clinical trial. Even I tell you, patients. If patients are also not understanding about clinical trial, sponsor, investigator, and ethics committee members. So my request is there that all of us, we should try to actually prepare some module for the training for each ethics committee. I think Urmila, she may be knowing some time back, actually DCGI has asked us to do actually the training program for sponsor, training program for investigator, and training program for ethics committee for 3 years. So I think that type of module has to be used, but it was done only in the major institutions, not in very small institutions. So we should actually do most of the places where because big institutions are already having all these type of training program, but small institution people are interested to do clinical trial, but they don't have formal training. They don't have formal, even they say that there is a requirement of one small office of ethics committee. So all these things are only possible when actually the person working on particular institution knows that these are the basic requirement. So I think that is one of the major thing we have to consider and do in future.
Yeah, I just like to add just one more thing, Urmila, before you finish it.
Yes,
the question which Sudha had asked, you know, it is very, very, very important. One is, you know, many people think that, you know, only institutions like All India Institute or KEM or St. John's and, you know, Nizam's and big institutions only will get funding. That's why they can do trials, and we cannot, we are all small institution, we can't get it. This is, I know, since I lived my life 30 years in ICMR, I know the issues, people do feel that, but then generally it's not that. You see, all the funding is ICMR, DST, DBT, and there are many more are ready to give funding to anybody, provided they submit a good proposal. So people don't realize that. They think that if you are a big organization, or you are very the power by even distance or anything, that's the reason the big institutions are getting and not others are getting. So I think when you organize the next one, we should have one session on what are the available funding, what are the funding agencies, because there are so many funding agencies which offer funds, which people are not aware of it. There are less takers and there are more funds in this country available. So maybe you got to have one session on the, what are the funding opportunities available for the academicians so that, you know, they can, they get the courage to submit proposals to various institutions and then they can get it. So it's not necessary always that, you know, you have to go to ICMR, DBT, DST. There are many more agencies which give funds. And of course, from the industries also, there are industries which conduct large number of training programs.
Right.
People should be aware of it. So there are two things. One is they should know what are the funding mechanisms available to them. Like, you know, somebody had written the DRDO, and all of them also doing a lot of funding. Second is that what are the training programs available? This is also something which is many people are not aware of the existing training programs. So maybe that can be added in your next program so that people know that, yes, this is a training program. They can attend this, learn something. And then these are the funding agencies. And if you have a good proposal, and anybody will be willing to fund. And just now, you know, in the, as I was talking to you, know, in the news pops up, which comes, I just read that the Prime Minister has said that the health industry is the one which is getting the highest increase of fund this time. So when the health industry, I recently heard the DG ICMR talking in one of the forums just 3 days back. And he said the ICMR budget is enhanced to a very great extent this time. So what I mean is ICMR is increased means the DBT, DST would have got even much more. So a lot of funds are available. People don't know how to write proposals and get the funding, and they keep blaming that the agencies don't give funding because they only give to the institutions known to them. They don't give to others, which is a very wrong impression. So I think this is something which we have to stress in the next conclave so that academicians know that what are the possibilities.
Thank you, Vasanta madam. I think that was a very important comment and very important guidance that you have given. Natesh, are you there? Have you joined?
Yes, madam. Yes,
would
yes,
you like to close the session, please? Because I think we have had with the president of the panel.
So thanks for every panelist. Nasreen. Nasreen, I thank all the participants formally. And like as I told, like you have to have more amount of training session. So we'll be discussing that, and we'll be coming up. Like we can do more such programs. So thank you once again. We'll be again meeting in the future conferences, future like more amount of training programs and the
like. Thank you, everyone. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you,
everyone.
Stay safe.
Thank you to all the panelists. Thank you so much, ma'am. Nadesh, thank you for giving me this opportunity.
Thanks, Sudha. Yeah, one more thing. Thanks, Sudha, for helping me out for this panel discussion. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.